Thank you,
thank
sir.
you for inviting me to this session of your four-day workshop. I thank the organizers for inviting me to this session, for conducting this. And this last session, I think I am the last batsman down in this four-day workshop.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I hope I will not bore you, and definitely I am going to show some very interesting aspects of 3D printing. I am not an expert in electrical vehicles, because I am going to speak on how 3D printing is, why it's becoming so popular in the present scenario. Everywhere you are hearing every day, or alternative hear a news in the newspaper, something is 3D printed like this. So let us see the scope of 3D printing. So I am not going to discuss fundamentals. I hope you are already done with the fundamentals. Just I am going to show the what are the various applications. I am going to concentrate. I hope you are seeing on my screen with various applications, like the left side top corner you are seeing. For example, a person gets injured on his skull. So this is called left parietal region of the skull. So if there is a fracture, then how you are going to put an implant for it? So let us see how conventionally they used to do, and with the help of 3D printing, how you are able to reduce the time. This is a live case study we have done. And I am going to present here how 3D printing plays a major role in this planning of surgeries, or in fact developing the implants for biomedical applications. The right side you are seeing, I hope most of you might be recognizing, this OVRM of a automobile, overview rear mirror. And have you anytime realized that how it is possible to put a LED light inside this? Such a very small space you are able to insert an electronic gadgets, which is very difficult to do with a conventional process. But with 3D printing, it's possible. So we will see the potential application of 3D printing in automobile industry, right? So that's where I think your workshop also on electrical vehicles. Electrical vehicles also, a lot of things are now being done, parts are done with 3D printing process, right? Not only this, we are going to see the here, the in the middle of this my PPT, you see these. I hope most of you might have seen this launch of the Perseverance rover by NASA in the month of February. So in this Perseverance rover, there are 11 metal 3D printed parts are there. So NASA is using this technology a lot in its space applications, aerospace applications. And not only this Perseverance, earlier when they were sent the Curiosity rover also, they use 3D printing technology a lot. So the application of 3D printing in aerospace, let us see that, how it is used. The center of this right side, you are able to see a very different types of shoes, which is generally is called sports shoes. This is developed by Reebok. It is called liquid speed sports shoe. And it has got a special design where you see the outer sole is linked, is joined with a particular type of mesh like thing. And it comes to the bottom one also. And you are seeing some kind of specialized substance kept inside it. So this will help the athletics, the person to run fast and to do all workouts, anything, the sports person. So you can see the application of additive manufacturing, you say 3D printing in sports industry. It is now used a lot, not only sports shoes, but different that I'm going to show with a video clipping how additive manufacturing can be used for, or 3D printing can be used for sports application. At the bottom, please observe my cursor, at the bottom, you are seeing agriculture big ploughing tool here. So I hope in agriculture industry, because India is very, you know, dependent on agriculture. We say agriculture is the backbone of our country, start from overland days. Now also, now we say IT, etc., but still agriculture is the main thing. And you see when some part, so small parts fails here in this big tool, so you have to completely stop using this one because of the lack of the small part. So if you have a 3D printing technology with you, you can directly build this part with the local 3D printer available to you. Instead of waiting for a supplier, you have to supply the spare part from a longer distance. That is from a original OEM, etc. For example, like pandemic disruption, the supply chain happens, everything. Then in that case, how to solve such type of issues? So nowadays, 3D printing is used in agriculture industry also a lot. Nowadays we are hearing the term called urban farming. In urban farming also, 3D printing is playing a major role in growing your own plants inside your home. That I am going to show a very interesting video, how 3D printing can be used in urban farming and agriculture field. Right, not only that, in India, we all like movies. I hope most of you like the India, we like three things. We like cricket, right? We like movies, and we like to eat very different types of food, right? So in this movie industry, like entertainment industry, also 3D printing is playing a major role. You see, observe here, the bottom one you can see, I hope you might have seen this movie called Iron Man. You have Iron Man series like Iron Man 1, 2, 3. Or you may be seeing the movie of Superman, the Kryptonic City of Superman, or in the Jurassic Park. You might be seeing all this, or Avatar, and all these very big hit movies, blockbuster movies. They are using 3D printing a lot. So you can see the application of 3D printing in entertainment industry. So not only that, you see at the bottom, recently a home has been constructed in Tamil Nadu using 3D printing. L&T used this one and made the first 3D printed home. So this 3D printing can be used for constructing homes itself. The complete, now you can build a colony using 3D printing technology. So the application of 3D printing in civil engineering is now is being used a lot, especially when you want to go with a project like giving house to many of the people in your country, right? So in that case, mass scale of production of these colonies, etc., you can do with less cost and within less time, you can use 3D printing. As I said earlier, we all like food, but can you think about making your customized food? So 3D printing is very famous for making customized things. So nowadays, 3D printing is now becoming very useful in food industry also. Now they're adopting food industry, like big companies like Hershey chocolates and different types of pizzas and other snacks you can make on your own. In fact, NASA is thinking to send the 3D printer to Mars, where the next expedition of NASA is to send humans to Mars through a rover. And when they send humans, the human has to, for example, you are doing anything, sir? Hello? Yeah. No, when you think about sending humans to Mars, they have to leave there, travel to take to reach Mars, it will take 1 hour, and there you have to spend another, sorry, one year it will take to reach Mars, it will take 1 year almost. And there you have to spend some experimentation, it may take to 2 to 3 years, and then coming back, it will take another 1 year. So how the astronauts are going to survive? There, in fact, is a very interesting project by NASA, how to make food in Mars. They are trying to use 3D print technology for making those food for the astronauts, right? We are going to see that very interesting clipping. Not only that, 3D printing is now being used in ornaments, in your jewelry application also. See this kind of very typical shape of the ornament, which is very difficult to make using conventional method with such a finish and such a complexity. But 3D printing helps a lot in making such type of application. So we'll see how 3D printing can be used for jewelry application. You can also see it here. Antenna, this is called, in electronic people know, this is called horn antenna. In fact, we have made a horn antenna using a 3D printing technology using FDM, and this is now becoming very popular in electronic applications. So not only this horn antenna, you are able to see most of the electronic gadgets, the casings of the electronic gadgets, or you might be seeing the handheld building instrument where the electricity person, or you are a bus person, he carries mobile, no, building machine with him. So that machine, you are putting a lot of electronics inside, but the entire casing you can make 3D print. So having such a complex things inside, you can make using 3D printing. So application of 3D printing in electronics is another very interesting area. Not only that, you see the right and bottom corner, you see a particular type of prop coming out of a wall. It appears like a horse is coming out of the wall. Nowadays, you don't want your home to have bare walls in interiors. Now, interior decoration is playing a very important role in lot of in construction industry, and interior industry is now adopting this 3D print technology to making to in to make such type of, you know, complicated, or to make such type of very beautiful props, which will make the people to enjoy it by seeing the wall, etc. It's like a realistic 3D model. It's not like a 2D wallpaper like that. So we can see how the application of 3D printing in interior decoration. So I'm going to concentrate. I don't know within 1 hour how far I will be completing this, but these are the major areas which I'll be concentrating here. Before that, I would like to say our Usmanabad University has got one of the best center of excellence in 3D printing. It is called Center for Product Design Development Additive Manufacturing. We established with 10 crores and with the support of the MHRD Government of India. And almost we have different technologies here. We have metal-based selective laser melting, metal 3D printing. We have SLS, selective laser sintering, which is also powder bed fusion, but polymer-based EOS machine. We have SLA DLP from 3D systems, the liquid resin-based system, stereolithography and direct light projection system we have. And then we have PolyJet from Statasys. Again, it's a resin-based system for finer application. For more complex things, you can use this one. We have an Ultimaker SY Pro FDM 3D printer. Like that, we have another 3D printer which was developed by our students. And also, we have another FDM printer, smaller version. So this is a very famous FDM 3D printer available in the world. And then we have the Artec 3D scanner also. So you can, this center has got all the different technologies and even reverse engineering you can do. We offer these two projects to our BE, ME, or not only any student who want to pursue is do some use our facility. We offer them with minimal academic pricing. We do it. They can do their project work. They can send their STL file. We build the product and send it to them. Or you want to use the comments, use the facilities. Of course, in the pandemic, it will be difficult. But later, if you want doing a PhD scholar, you want to use our facilities, you are welcome to it. We also do consultancy works with different organizations with around Hyderabad. We also work with hospitals around Hyderabad in solving some complex surgeries, right? So this center is led by Director Professor Sira Venkatesh. I am the joint director for this center, just to give the audience what facilities we can offer to all of them. So these are areas, as I said, we'll be concentrating. I hope most of you know these basic definitions of 3D printing. All of you know, basically 3D printing is adding from a CAD model, you convert into an triangulation, you do it and add one layer or another layer and build the product. It is or the CAD model you can get from the using a standard software, you can build up the CAD model, or if it's a biomedical application using a CT MRI scan in DICOM format, you can use that and build a CAD model. From that, you can send it to the machine produce, or already existing product is there, you can as well as do the digitizing, this reverse engineering you can do, or re-engineering you can do, build a CAD model and then send it to the machine. You add one layer or another layer and build it. It is the opposite to the conventional subtractive manufacturing, where you remove the material. The best thing of additive manufacturing is the amount of material loss is less. And also you can say that this is called positive manufacturing and a part of sustainable manufacturing process. In fact, we are doing another interesting project where we want to check what is the effect of additive manufacturing on environment when compared with the conventional manufacturing. That project is underway, and we'll let you know shortly what are the results of these things also, right? So because any manufacturing thing now should be eco-friendly. And basically, you know, the basic steps in 3D printing process is that you have to make a CAD model, convert into STL file, the triangulation you have to do, then you have to transfer it to the machine where you want to build the part. There you have to do machine setup parameters like what is the layer thickness, what is the orientation which you want to build, what if, for example, you are doing FDM, what is the infill, whether you want to have a hollow part, whether you want to have a solid one, that you have to take care. If you are doing a powder bed fusion technology, or think about what is the laser intensity, what is the type of support structure, everything. Those things you have to think about before you start building the part itself, because this is very important phase in any 3D printing. If the CAD model is not correct, not given with proper tolerances, the end product will be a failure. It's like garbage in, garbage out. So once you do it, then you build the part, adopting different technologies as per your application. Then once you get the part, then you have to remove the support structures. Then you have to do some post-processing like sandblasting or air blasting, or you do curing process, or depending on the technology you adopt, you do it. Then finally you get the part. These are the basically 8 steps you find in any 3D printing technology. Let me first concentrate on how we use 3D printing for solving this critical case. We have done several biomedical applications. I can give a 2.5 hour lectures. We've done a lot of cases with biomedical, but here, because the time is very short, I'm going to present one application of how we use 3D printed for solving this cranioplasty surgery, right? What is basically cranioplasty is, it's defined as a neurosurgical procedure to cover an injured bone in the skull. So this is what happens is when there's an injury on the skull, you have to put a implant over it. So for that one, what is the challenge for any surgeon who makes this one is, not only the implant you put should be is successful, but it should not affect its aesthetic sense. That means the implant that you put should not prop up so that whenever the patient sees his face in the mirror, it should not appear uneven, it should not feel psychologically unstable, right? So it should be made in such a way that it should be natural, like nothing that it should appear that no operation has been done. So the main challenge in cranioplasty surgery is not only putting a right implant, but also restore the appearance and psychological stability of the patient. So in our case, we got a patient, a 16 years old boy who got injured on this is called the left parietal region of the skull. So this skull has broken, and what doctors they have done is they have put a skin on it and stitched around it. Now inside you have a brain inside that. Now you have to develop an implant. this person came from to our hospitals in Hyderabad, that is Care Banjara Hills. Dr. Satish from there approached us. We have a 3D printing center. This happened around 8 years back. And at that time, we have a center called Center for CPTIP, Center for Product Prototyping Testing of Industrial Products, which has got SLS mission, selective laser sintering machine. He approached us, he asked us to help us in solving this using a 3D printing technology. So our first question was, for example, there is no 3D printing, how we used to solve this case? So what he has done, what he explained us, earlier they used to remove the entire hair of the patient, put an algae around him, the plaster paris like that to put around it. Now they put a basket and apply an algae. And now this and with the skill set of the doctor, they used to take an impression how the fracture has happened. So what is the problem with this is the patient is made to sit in operations theater to get an impression of how the fracture happened. This itself may take 6 to 8 hours time. And not only that, the impression that you may get may not be exactly as per that fracture. Right? It all depends on the, if it is not experienced doctor, again, this may be vary. And if you are not making a correct impression, because the idea there is using this impression, they make it as a pattern using this as a pattern, they make a mold. Inside that mold, they pour biocompatible material, polymethyl, methacrylate, and finally build the implant. But using this approximated implant, what happens then, the actual implant that you make may not exactly suiting that fracture. And during the operation time, there is a problem with what you call the excess material in the implant, etc., because of which the doctor has to do trimming during the surgery itself, and which will lead to utilization of more surgical time, contamination of the field, and sometimes rejection of the processes. This is the problem with the existing method. That's why doctor approached us, sir, you have a center, you can help us in solving this case. It is a very challenging one. And we have become a project of my MTech students, and we asked doctor to supply the CT scan image. So CT scan image in the DICOM format. DICOM is called digital imaging and communication medicine. Once we have taken this CT scan image, then we immediately build a CAD model. So as I said, we mechanical engineers use your CAD knowledge for a different domain, that is biomedical domain. We used it, whatever we learned in mechanical, like mirroring or cutting or splitting, all these commands, we used it. And of course, we have used another software before we model. We use MIMIC software, which is image density segmentation software, image processing software. And there's a lot of procedure, how you convert this one to CAD model. I am not going to explain all those because it will take a lot of time. There is your take care of thresholding and segmentation, all those you have to take. So using these tools, we developed the CAD model and we have shown it to the doctor. Doctor was, this CAD model, doctor able to see how the fracture happened. So this fracture is not a regular any geometry. It's not a circle. It's not an ellipse. It's a very different pattern altogether. So doctor said that you manufacture the entire skull. You are thinking that instead of putting that human being, you will put the skull and take an impression of it. But this skull itself will cost around 50 to 60,000 because it's an SLS material, cost is very high. So actually you are not going to put this into the patient. So who is going to spend money for this one? So we said, what you require? He said, I require only this portion. We have answered him that we can make only this portion. And we have mirrored this and duplicated these points to this side. And we have developed the CAD model of how this looks, this implant, how it looks. And the CAD we have shown. And we have even superimposed how it will look once we put it. And the doctor said, you please go ahead. Then we have used our SLS technology, our EOS machine, this forming a P100. Of course, what I am telling is I am not making the direct implant here. I am making a pattern of the implant. So using this pattern of the implant, he is going to make a mold. And in that mold, he is going to pour polymethyl methacrylate and produce the final implant, right? So whatever forming a P100 is, we have polyamide powder, we use that one, right? So using the technology, I am not going in depth how SLS works, everything, assuming that you all know the working principle fundamentals of the different technologies. I am not going into depth of that. So we made the SLS, pattern or the model of the implant using SLS technology. And then this serves as a pattern for making the final biocompatible implant. Then we have fixed it to the patient. And you see this is a gap we are given from the parent Want to this one, and in this gap, because we have to give 1 or 2 mm, depend, this will be told by the doctor, because depending on the age, what is the growth rate, etc. And they have put what you call this mini plates. It's like a riveted joint like that. They have fixed it here in different places. So you can do, as a mechanical engineer, you can do impact analysis, you can do finite element analysis, stress distribution, everything you can do. So when this was fixed, the patient was happy. And what we are, what is the thing we are reduced is, we reduced that getting impression time, 6 to 8 hours time, we reduced completely, we eliminated that. And this is more far accurate, and we have finished it. And we reduced the time by 22%. This is what 3D printing can work in biomedical application, in not only solving critical cases, but even planning the surgery. So reducing the time, everything. So this is just one example of how 3D printing can be used for biomedical application. This is what we certificate we got. Later, we have done a lot of such critical operations using this 3D printing technology, like this type of fractures on the both the left side and right side, both sides fracture, everything. We use our spline curve. What are the CAD knowledge you have, you can use that and develop the model. Even we use the FDM for some application, that much of accuracy is not required. We use the FDM technology. So this is what the application of 3D printing in biomedical field. Let us see, moving ahead, you have any questions? I think question answer is the end of the session, right? Right, sir? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, right.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. At the end of the session. Yes, sir.
Right. Right. So, aerospace application, let us see. What you are seeing on the screen is this bottom one you see, this is a rover. As I said, NASA is planning to send this rover to Mars with astronauts, two astronauts. So, this rover, the challenge for this rover is it should have lightweight. You are lifting such a heavy vehicle from Earth to Mars. It's not that easy, right? So for that, you require parts that are lighter in weight, but at the same time should withstand the harsh atmosphere of Mars, like extreme cold, extreme hot, etc. So they're using FDM technology. They're using what you call the Stratasys FDM process. They're using and developing 70 FDM parts, so which are used in this. Let us see that video in the coming slides. Not only this, the rover, as I said, the Perseverance rover, they are using the 11 metal parts developed by 3D print technology. Even in our Tejas lightweight multi-role jet fighters, they use 3D print technology. In fact, I think one of the speakers in your session is Dr. U. Chandrasekhar and son. He worked in this project. I'll show the slide what he has said during this project. He was at that time director for GTRA. And in fact, we have used 3D printing for making a CubeSat as a part of our MTech trend. We made CubeSat as the smallest satellite launched by the space organization like ISRO and other things. They do from specific applications like weather monitoring or some other identifying the minerals, etc., all of those applications. So this is a very interesting project by NASA. It's called 3D printing a space vehicle. NASA's human supporting rover has FDM parts. And this is a Desert Rats research and technology studies. So you can see this rover, which has a pressurized cabin to support astronauts, includes about 70 FDM parts, including housing, vents and fixtures, the inside AC ducts and outside the supports like this, the small other things. They are all made using 3D print technology. Let us watch this video to understand how NASA is using this technology in the space applications.
We retired the space shuttle this past year after 30 years of excellent service to our nation.
Are you able to see the video, sir?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Audio, video, both is fine.
Okay, right. Thank you.
And it's time it had done. It had been a fantastic program. It had done amazing things. But now NASA is ready to really take the next step, which is a more continued presence in outer space beyond low Earth orbit. Our ultimate goal is to get humans to Mars. When we started this project, we thought we were really clever thinkers. We had some technology we wanted to explore that involved multiple wheels and the ability to turn in any direction. We thought, well, what if we build a cabin and have the crew go out for multiple days? That's really where this small pressurized rover concept has really evolved into a space exploration vehicle.
So the SEV will hold two astronauts. They basically live in this module, in this rover. It's your own personal SUV in space. You always want it to be as light as possible. You also want it to be strong. strong enough that it's got your safety factors so that nobody's going to get hurt. You're going at several thousand miles per hour just to escape the Earth's atmosphere. So you've got to be able to handle all these vibrations and all these different things just to be able to get out into space. And the vehicle can't be damaged. There's probably around 60 to 80 parts on this particular rover. It's all done by additive manufacturing for a lot of different reasons. You know, sometimes traditional manufacturing methods don't really work for some parts that you want to build, where you can do it with additive manufacturing, and it's really simple. It really takes no effort for what would otherwise be a very complex process. Whether it be ducting that's got flame retardant characteristics and properties to it to help keep people safe, or different fixtures and different parts, there's absolutely a place for additive manufacturing. There's a lot of things that you don't see that really get to go on is the design verification and the functionality checks of parts before we send them to be manufactured. If the final product is not going to be an additive manufacturing plastic part, we will do it in a rapid prototype fashion where you'll get it back in maybe an hour, a day. What that allows us to do is be able to check our design and make sure that everything's going to work the way we think it is. Sometimes vendor components are a little bit different than what you anticipated, what the drawings say. So you're able to functionally build up this assembly and check it to say, hey, this is what we want, or hey, we need to make some tweaks. So by doing additive manufacturing rapid prototyping, it allows you to keep your costs down. Everybody's got a budget to deal with. And
so this is how 3D printing can be used for the technology. You can see this, our Tejas lightweight multi-role jet fighter. In the words of Dr. U. Chandrasekharan, sir, he says that with FDM, we created an engineering prototype that perfectly reflected our design intent and facilitated the complex engine development. They, in fact, they use FDM technology to produce 2,500 parts, and the model helped engineers best lay out complex piping runs. This, what they found is conventional fabrication is taking around $60,000, whereas and it is taking 12 months time, whereas using direct digital, that is FDM technology, they are able to produce using $20,000 and then 1.5 months. So you are saving money by 66% and the time also by 87.5%. This is the observation made by Dr. U. Chandrasekharan on the application of 3D printing aerospace. Even the NASA Perseverance rover, you might have seen, launched in the February 18, 2021. It carries 11 metal parts made with 3D printing. Even the Curiosity rover used 3D printing technology for its instrument called Sample Analysis at Mars, SAM instrument. They use this 3D printing technology. And in the Perseverance rover, they for making this planetary instrument for X-ray lithochemistry, it's like a lunchbox sized device, help the rover to seek out signs of fossil microbial life by shooting X-ray beams at rock surface to analyze them. So the outer shell of the Pixel, one of the instruments aboard NASA Perseverance Mars rover, includes several parts that are made of 3D printed titanium, etc. So this is what you can see. Even the this is called MOXIE, Mars Oxygen In-Situ Resource Utilization Experiment, where they want to see that once astronauts again wants to come back from Mars to Earth, they require a lot of oxygen for the rocket propellant. So how to develop those things? So for that, they are using this instrument. And in that, you can see this kind of 3D printed heat exchanger. They are using this 3D printing technology for making this one. Like that, the Curiosity rover of Mars expedition, the entire model has got different assemblies produced by 3D printing technology. You can see these assemblies like wheel assembly, suspension assembly, robotic arm, and all these things. They are printed using 3D print technology to test it. They use Ultimaker for producing this part. In fact, we have done, one of my MTech students, myself, I guided him to work on a project on design optimization of a nanosatellite structure and prototype manufacturing using rapid prototyping process. This we got the chance to present in ISRO in the National Conference on Large-Scale Multidisciplinary System of National Security Trends and Challenges, held at Sierra Kota. And what is the reason? Basically, a nanosatellite is a very miniaturized satellite, and it is having the size of 1 U and the volume of 1 liter. Since it is a form of a cube, it is also called CubeSat. And you, what is the advantage? You can have a modular one, 1 U, 2 U, like this. So basically, these CubeSats are, you see, they launch 100 satellites or 30, 40 satellites at a time. Among them, most of them will be CubeSat doing some specific purpose as per the requirements, right? So this is the design we have taken from the CubeSat design specification from California, and we modeled it. There are different structures you can use here, but we selected this similar head and foot concept structure because it has got less number of parts and you can easily expand from 1 year to 1.5 or less manufacturing time and cost, etc. We adopted this and we made this model, the entire thing in our CAD model, software, and we produced the entire one using Ultimaker, even the screws, bolts, etc. Inside this, you can put the printed circuit boards and use for your required application. So this is how 3D printing can be used for space applications, right? Like that micro air vehicles, unmanned air vehicles, doing some specific tasks like identifying the insurgents, you can send this, and the surgical team can strike after this will go and identify that. This MAV goes and identify the place of that insurgent, and this can be used by the surgical team for getting into a specific area and target that. So this is how 3D printing can be used. And let us see how 3D printing can be used in agriculture industry, right? So agriculture is a very backbone of our country. So we need to help farmers also in applying this innovative technology. Why? Because there are no boundaries for 3D printing. It's only your creativity, your thought will make you its application. So, right? So for example, you are thinking about, as I said, this kind of pluffing make a very big one in agriculture field they use. And they are heavy and expensive machines. To replace just one part, it can be quite expensive, or the part of that farmer is searching for, it may not be on the market anymore. It may be outdated. Then additive manufacturing plays a very important role, which makes it possible to print spare parts for farming machines, etc. Similarly, this is another interesting concept called urban farming. There are some kind of parts intervention. Sir, talking, sir. They are, please mute them, sir. Okay. Shall I continue? Yeah. Now this is a Exagro urban farming is another way, because in future the amount of open spaces comes down, and agriculture, it all depends on the outside environment, etc. And in that case, how to solve this, because we all require food to survive, so you cannot escape that. So for that, why can't you cultivate these things in your home itself? So this company is trying to innovate with urban farming. This is an Italian startup company called Exagro Urban Farming. Now they are building these hanging gardens, and for making these hanging gardens, you require connectors. So this connector is very typical in shape, so which you can make only using 3D printing technology. So 3D printing applied for agriculture, but for urban farming. Let us watch this video about how they want to use this technology for agriculture.
Have you ever wondered how to feel closer to nature in your house? This is the Living Farming Tree, a uniquely designed plug-and-play system to grow food anytime, anywhere. Insert the bars and the connectors, place the farming modules, and transplant your seedlings. Plug the system to electricity and connect to a Wi-Fi connection. Download the app and you're ready to grow. Through its modular sensors, the Living Farming Tree will measure several parameters in your house and will automatically adapt the system for the efficient growth of your plants. When the system is in need of attendance, it will send push notifications directly to your smartphone. Use your smartphone to plan your crops, monitor your system's activity, and gather information to share with your fellow urban farmer friends. Easy to unpack and assemble, you will be able to adapt the Living Farming Tree to the space available in your house and start producing delicious, healthy food with just a few clicks. The cities of the world host over half of the global population. By 2050, this number is expected to grow up to 80%. Who will farm the food we need to feed our planet? Collaborative urban farming is a regenerative solution to decentralize food production, enhance its supply chain, and increase food quality within cities. But sometimes weather conditions are not ideal, crops are attacked by plagues, and space available for farming and time for maintenance can be limited. The Living Farming Tree is an indoor farming system developed by taking inspiration from nature, mimicking strategies to reduce space while maximizing yield of production. It uses aeroponics, the most advanced technology to grow food without soil. You can either start with a basic configuration and scale up your system to produce more than 200 plants, or you can buy the full configuration from the start.
This is what you can use for urban farming. You can also see such type of small parts which are there, and there in agriculture industry use it. And then to test this one, every time you're making a metal part is very difficult also. To test it, you can use prototyping using a polymer-based FDM technology to test whether it works correctly or not. Once you freeze it, then you go for the actual metal part. So this is a way how you save money and also time. So 3D printing can be used to test agriculture devices, right? And even this type of drone can be used to carry out computerized control tasks such as mechanical weeding and watering, etc., or fertilizer spraying. So in making all these things type of drones, you can use 3D printing technology a lot. So there are several applications like drip irrigation, the nozzles that are used in the drip irrigation that you can 3D print. Let us come to the application of 3D printing in sports industry. So what you are seeing on the screen is a typical stumps which you are seeing nowadays every format of the cricket, like T20 match or One Day International, or you can call it as a test match. Everywhere this became a default wicket system. Let us see how this 3D printing played a role in this developing this wicket system. Not only this, the shoes, or you can see the safety gear helmet on by the cricket batsman, or any in any rugby ball, anywhere this is used nowadays, or even the Formula One car race. Or you can see this golf bats, etc. They're using 3D printing technology a lot in most of the sports industry also. So this is a typical match you might have seen. So this type of wicket system is called zinc wicket system. These are also called flashing wickets. Can you imagine how you put these LED lights inside the stumps and bales? Very small one. It's earlier days, they're all dead stumps made of wood. Nothing is live. And the specialty of these stumps is not only it will help the umpire to make a right decision, the third umpire, technically correct, also it gives some kind of aesthetic look to the spectators who are sitting in the stadium and watching IPL match in the day and night. And you see this flying, and it appears like a Diwali cracker from the ground moving, flying away. So this is how 3D printing helps in not only solving technical thing, but also aesthetic way. This is why wicket system was first introduced in the Australian domestic cricket. Later in 2015 World Cup, this was first introduced in the official format of the game. This was developed by Bront Ackerman, an Australian mechanical industrial designer, and created by South Australian manufacturer Zing International. So they use 3D print technology for making such type of wicket system, right? Not only this, the Revoc liquid shoes, this is a very typical shoe. The shoes is designed for distance running, cardio workouts and comfort. And you can see they developed their own 3D printing system using the robotics and state-of-the-art technology. Liquid factory draws shoes in a 3D. A special high rebound liquid is used to draw shoe componentry cleanly, precisely, and in three-dimensional layer. This entire outsole you can see fixed to the main shoe part from starting from the bottom. And you see this inside this, please observe my cursor, this is the black one. There are a special type of liquid that is called urethane-based liquid that could be drawn on to create an outsole that melts with the lacing on the shoes. So this will be fixed with the lacing on the shoes. What is the advantage is when running, a certain amount of energy is going to the ground. So when the shoe hits the ground, in this case, it absorbs energy, then it returns it. That's why it is called high rebound. The technology they used is liquid drawing or pneumatic material extrusion process. Not only Reebok, but many of the shoe manufacturing companies, leading shoe manufacturing companies like Adidas, Nike, Under Armour, New Balance, Reebok, they are using this technology. Like Adidas uses DLS technology, direct light sintering carbon for it making, using polyurethane, they make midsoles, upper arms and other parts like that. Nike uses SLS technology, or Under Armour also uses SLS technology, selective laser sintering technology. New Balance uses SLA, stereolithography, resin-based technology for making rubber durable resin materials they use. And they make other parts like cleats, heels, and outsoles. Similarly, Reebok uses its own developed 3D print technology, material extrusion liquid drawing system. Then they use the various technology like polyurethane, they use TPU and all those things and make different parts of the shoes. Let us see the application of 3D printing in other sports industry with this video. Thank you. you can see a lot of application of 3D printing in sports application. Like that in entertainment industry, like your filmmaking industry, especially the movies like Avatar, Hulk, or you can see the Terminator, Iron Man 1, 2, 3, the Lord of Rings, the entire the battlefield in all those things, or the weaponry they use in the movie. Or you see the movie like Pacific Rim, where the huge gigantic robots. Earlier, they used to use mostly computer graphics, but now people start, audience slowly started realizing it's a graphic. They want to make more realistic. So Hollywood adopted this technology a lot, and there's a studio called Legacy Studio, which makes all these type of things, and a lot of engineers works in this. If you see the studio, it appears like not a movie making, it appears like a factory running out and making different types of parts. They adopt FDM technology, they adopt PolyJet technology, they adopt different liquid, or sometimes they go for, if the budget is high, they go for metal parts also, right? So the Kryptonic City of Superman, or in the Jurassic Park movie, in all these things, they use the technology. Let us watch this video on how Legacy Studios uses this technology for making different types of movies in hit movies. You can see this.
Legacy Effects creates practical effects for hundreds of movies and commercials annually, from creature design to prosthetic makeup to animatronics to specialty suits. Our approach incorporates the latest in 3D printing technology with a deep pool of artistic talent. The founding partners at Legacy Effects supervised projects at Stan Winston Studios for 25 years. It was there nearly a decade ago that 3D printing really started to emerge in the special effects workflow.
Terminator movie, they're using FDM.
Back at Stan Winston Studio, the design department
is
Transformers working on more visual effects rather than practical. So we started playing with different technologies
physical
to work hand in hand more with the traditional physical effects that Stan Winston was producing. Fabrication department, the mechanical department,
how many engineers are working in this
mold making department, and the model shop.
If you have a skill set of 3D design, movie making, you can, if you have developed the skill set, you can work in this big budget.
Alan Scott was
approached. So, what is interesting part is you might have seen this watch parts on the screen. What they do is basically they try to scan actors in different action sequences, different facial expressions. That then they make
depicted a massive
ways they'll make figurines. They're called figurines.
Control camera all this went over a stage that was 70
and
feet
and they
long
put a battle scenario.
You had vignettes and scenarios,
camera
explosions, shots of agony,
it's like
people
naturally
getting
it is happening.
Hundreds of different
that
poses.
They use combination of computer graphics
really
and this.
We utilized the artists that were still in that design room, taking the game assets and converting them into stereolithography files that we could send to a service bureau
to
actually produce physical.
Using 3D modeling, we would grow some just to be molded. We would break them apart with arms and legs and heads, put it on a body,
tell most of
a variety of different poses.
Mechanism
on that
means only
but there were some that were so specific that we spent a whole battery of actors in different expressions
can work
and then glue their faces, and then we would populate them on different figurines.
That's right.
It was a perfect testing platform because in the delivery and the amount of characters that needed to be done, traditional sculpting, it would never work just within the deadline.
This tool allowed us to do that job.
When we got into projects like Iron Man, we did a variety of maquettes through 3D printing, additive manufacturing, in acrylics or you know whichever materials that were being offered up at the time. That was so successful, just growing those maquettes, that I ran some numbers and tried to figure out, well, maybe we could utilize this process in growing the.
So like this, in this movie making, you can see the Iron Man entire suit, these different parts of the suit are made using FDM printer, using PLA material. In the movie called Zero Dark 30, where the night, these goggles, night vision goggles of the Navy SEALs in that movie, actually the movie maker wanted to buy it, it was costing very high. So they use 3D printing to replicate the entire goggles so that it appears like the original one. And similarly, the Hobbit trilogy, all this weapon, the helmet and all this set, they are made using 3D printing technology. Like the Guardians of the Galaxy, this very innovative weaponry they made using 3D printing. Like the Maleficent, like a lot of movies, or even our Bahubali in film, the entire prototype model of the set was is a Mumbai-based soft company, which replicated the entire set here. So you can use 3D printing entertainment industry a lot. Now coming to the food processing industry, So it's becoming another very interesting area where 3D printing is penetrating like anything. And the technologies which are most popular here are binder jetting, powder bed technology, material jetting, paste extrusion, inject, and indirect mold process. So why you require 3D printed food is you have a different eating experience, because people always want to have some different experience, right? And then a cooking experience, someone likes cooking, you can have a different cooking experience using a 3D printer. You can have customized, designed food you can have, and you want to have a, for example, some person is having a deficiency of vitamin D, you can have that only the nutrient supplement that is required that you can put more in that food and you can make their customized food. Right, so these are some of the benefits you have. Customization, co-creation, nutrition, flavor, you can have your own color, you can have your texture, on-demand, on-the-go production you can have, but generally suited for low-volume productions, flexibility in all these applications you can use. But there are challenges. You have to think about the shape stability, you have to think about the traditional foods, how you can replicate using 3D printing. And another important is the rheology of the food material because they vary by time. So stable print materials you have to need. And most important challenge is safety, easy to use clean surface and cartridges, etc. So NASA now adopting this technology, because it may take 3 years to complete for the people who goes to Mars and do the entire expedition. So the mission, and during that time, astronauts need to eat, and NASA is looking into ways to enhance their life support system, including the possibility of 3D printing meals. So they've given this one to a company called Systems and Materials Research Corporation. They are working on this, developing a 3D printer which can be used in, I think most of you know already, NASA has sent a 3D printer to International Space Station. There is a challenge is whenever there is some small spare part to be repaired, what happens, you have to lift that tool required from Earth to there. It is very costly affair. Instead of that, why can't you print the same tool in the space itself? So they have sent a 3D printer to space recently, in 4 to 5 years back. So you are able to, what are the minimum tools required? They're able to do it in the International Space Station itself. So let us watch this video.
US space agency NASA is funding a company to develop 3D printing of foods. Advocates of 3D printing technology say delivering long life foods from alternative ingredients could help solve the problem of feeding astronauts and ease food shortages on Earth. Manned space missions require stocks of non-perishable foods. 3D printing could be a promising solution to the problem of feeding crews. Traditionally, food sources perish easily. Proteins, vitamins, fibers, and carbohydrates can be derived from alternative nutrient sources like insects, grasses, algae, and seeds. Stored as powders, they can last for years. When combined with sugars and oils, nutritionally dense foods can be created layer by layer. NASA will provide U.S. firm and Jan contractor.
So this is one example.
U.S. space
printing can be used for the food industry. And another interesting area is the jewelry industry. Now you want to get sustainable, different types of jewelry nowadays you are getting. Earlier used to do with manual method, other CNC machining, but as the complexity increases, those technologies are unable to support. So using 3D printer in jewelry is becoming very popular. Especially there are two ways in which you can do 3D printing in jewelry, either by investment casting method or direct printing. So investment casting method, what you need to is you have to make that pattern of that jewelry using any of the 3D print technology. Most of the popular 3D print technology used for jewelry making are SLA and DLP technology, indirect method of producing jewelry. So stereolithography, DLA process, they print this pattern, they make the mold assembly, then they dip like investment casting, they dip in a slurry, and once the shell is formed, they burn out, this type of wax pattern will melt away, and then they pour liquid gold and you get the part printed. So you get the part produced, right? This is how 3D printing can be used in jewelry industry for indirect way of doing it. The popular technology, like, you know, you can make this. In fact, we have one of my students who used this technology using the Creo SolidWorks that she modeled, and she converted STL file she produced using SLA in our SLA DLP machine. She used the jewel cast resin and made this prototype of the earrings and pendants, etc. She has made. Like that, you can make all those things. And then we adopt the investment casting process. We produce similar type of silver jewelry using this pattern made with SLA or DLP technology. So this is what, when we are about to print in the machine, these are how we have put this orientation, stacking we have done on the build platform and produced it. And this is a cache jewelry tree, another one developed by Formlabs, etc., using Formlabs. And this is a technology used here is mostly in investment caching, SLA or DLP technology. So the material may be castable resin, or you may have jewel SL, jewel cast, and like this, different materials you can use for using this technology. Or you have a direct printing process also. You may use direct metal laser sintering or SLU, selective laser melting. Here you use the powder bed fusion technology and use powder and sinter it or melt it and make the required jewelry, produce it. So that's how you can use 3D printing in jewelry making. This is used by a lot of companies. And the popular printers used are Model Pro 2 and Envision Tech or Project 3510 or T76. The software that generally used is Rhinoceros or JewelCAD. You have a separate software called JewelCAD. You can build your own type of customized jewelry you can make. That's how 3D printing is becoming very popular. And let us see in the automobile industry, how you are able to use 3D printing in automobile industry. So all these parts, what you are seeing, observing here, they are made using 3D print technology, like the car bumper or the tail lamp or the car dashboard or a complex functional ducting design printed in SLS system or the rear wiper motor cover, or you can see the ORVM. So all these things are using 3D print technology. They're basically used in automobile industry for communication, validation, pre-production runs, etc. And these are the various technologies that they adopt here. Like for under the hood, they use SLS technology. They use material nylon and they make battery cover, which is having heat resistant functional parts. Interior accessories, they make use SLA and resin, and they make customized cosmetic components like console, prototype, etc. So these are the various technologies like SLS or SLA or metal based DMLS, like suspension, wishbone they use. So these are how 3D printing is becoming very popular in these applications, right? So Ford uses this 3D print technology a lot, and in the electric vehicles also, the Ford using electric, the Ford or the Tesla, they are using this technology in making different parts of the electrical vehicle.
Innovation is in our DNA at Ford. We've been innovating ever since the moving assembly line, and we've carried that tradition forward with the work we do here in the Research and Advanced Engineering Organization. This organization is responsible for developing new technologies and working with partners to bring those technologies to Ford Motor Company. We're using 3D printers in prototyping of parts right now. It's uniquely suited for that because we can print parts right after you design a concept and see if it's the design that you really want. And that opens up a new design process where you can iterate more quickly. Ford is a pioneer partner of Desktop Metal, and that's given us access to their equipment. We've had a Desktop Metal Studio printer here, and we've been using it to print parts, to evaluate the materials, then to evaluate the parts that are printed on it. Building on that innovation, we now have advanced 3D printing methods like binder jet technology, which opens up the possibility to 3D print at much higher speeds and at much larger scale. These 3D printed parts can be used to prototype components that go into our vehicle. We also use them to make manufacturing aids and fixtures, and we're increasingly using them now in limited scale production examples as well. We have in production a GT500 part. That's one of our performance vehicles. We're really excited about bringing that to the market later this year. And then on our F-150 Raptor vehicle, we have a 3D printed part that goes into one of the electrical plugs that needed to be sealed off for a particular market. So it was a great example of where a 3D printed part could go into a region and modify the vehicle to be sold in that region without disrupting the at-scale manufacturing process for other regions. But long term, as you look into the future, we're looking at many ways to integrate 3D printing into what we call the factory of the future. We're prototyping many concepts today, both in virtual space and in the physical space, where we're proving out some of those concepts. We see the possibility of creating future factories where 3D printing is an integral part of the manufacturing method that's used in that future vision. That's why we're so excited to be partnering with Desktop Metal, because it's opening up the possibility for that scale to be realized at Ford.
So this can be used in automobile industry a lot. Now this is becoming a very popular application of 3D printing. Let us see its application in electronic industry. So in fact, I worked under my guidance students, BE students now, they worked on developing this what you call HAN antenna using 3D print technology. We use SketchUp make software. I teach this subject as open elective to other branches. So I got the opportunity to guide electronic students to work on this. And we developed a model prototype model of this HAN antenna. And we produced it here using our FDM finder, flash force finder, we produced it. And we have then coated it with a metallic paint like XTC 3D to improve the signal transmission capacity. And it is being, how it is different from a conventional HAN antenna is they use sheet metal work to make. And when you use sheet metal, you will not get that kind of good finish here at the ends, at the corner especially. But using 3D printing, you can make all those things. So this is a very popular area in electronics application. You can see a lot of papers work on this using 3D printing for making this HAN antennas or communication purpose. Right, like that in the electronic industry, they're using 3D printing a lot, and the most popular technologies are inkjet and aerosol. And out of that, aerosol jet technology is very popular because it doesn't have any nozzle clogging, etc. So the concept of print me a phone, you can use the entire phone, you can print using this 3D print technology. Even the printed circuit boards, everything you can print here. This is a Nokia concept phone. They developed using 3D print technology on the part. Now I'm going to how you are using 3D printing in construction industry. Right, before you make the actual big building block, etc., you can make a prototype, the architect can make a prototype and explain to customer how it looks. In fact, what I have done is, in this work, we have Usman City has got the legacy. We are 100 years old, recently completed, and we have a very legacy arts college building. So which doesn't have much of the plans are not available outside. So we, our civil students went there and surveyed the entire thing, got all the photographs. Then mechanical students used CATIA software and modeled that. And we produced this using 3D printing technology, the prototype of that in three models, three blocks we produced and joined together. So you get a complete, so that you, it appears like a single piece. So like that using 3D without losing any, the intricacies, everything, we kept every feature of that building is seen here. So you can make, so before you make a Olympic stadium, you can make a replica of that, explain how it looks, etc. In fact, 3D printing now being used in complete livable houses, they are printing now. Let us see this 3D printed homes. This is what we have done here. So in fact, we have collected data from our arts college. I don't know how many have visited our Usman University, Hyderabad, and seen this arts college, very big legacy building, heritage monument is, right? So we use this technology, we modeled this, and we use this flash for the FDM 3D printer. We made these parts in three parts we made, and we joined together, and finally we printed here, right? So this is how the printing process went, and we built it, and you can see different views, the top view, side view, how intricate we can make the entire part, right? So this, how you can use 3D printing for that application. And even this recently in Chennai, the L&T produced this 3D printed building completely. And this is the, this took around, I think, in, around 90.
எல்லாருக்கும் வணக்கம். இது ஆண்டர்பிரினர் ஐடியாஸ் யூடியூப் சேனல். இன்னைக்கு என்ன டாபிக் பத்தி பார்க்க போறோம்னா, L&T வந்து,
so you can see in this video, so this is how the 3D printing process goes here. This is a 3D printer constructing this entire on the house. You can see the two stories, first floor and the second floor. So without any extra assembly they are doing here, this is how the 3D printing goes. You can watch this in this entrepreneur ideas, you can get the information. Now this is the next where the, you want to construct all this for build a colony entirely very fast. So you can use this technology a lot. Right, similarly in interior industry also you are finding this application, right? So like making these props, etc., which will make a different look to the, your wall entirely. So this is a very big area. People are working a lot. and making these, you know, people even having a simple knowledge of how to use a 3D printer, have the creativity of making those props, you can use this technology. So finally, because my session I have to complete within 1 hour, what I would say the future of AM is, if you see the Gartner's 3D printed hype cycle curve, so it, with a lot of hype, it started, you know, innovation triggers and peak of inflated expectations was there. And then later they found the limitations and there was a lot of disillusionment and people thought you cannot use this and that, etc. And then it came down. But later, once you are able to overcome the limitations and your maturity level increased and your 3D printing technology evolved, now it is becoming into the plateau of productivity. You are into the plateau of productivity. Now we are in this era where now 3D printing is now replacing the entire conventional things in many ways. So this is the next area of work where most of us should concentrate. That's why this is a part of Industry 4.0. That's how 3D printing became a thrust area of our Indian government, the skill set development. So you can see any website, DST or AICT, is one of the thrust areas of 3D printing. I hope nowadays a lot of Atal AICT programs are being conducted on 3D printing and design. So I thank my principal for the support. In fact, we work a lot on biomedical applications and we are now into this other application also. I thank my director and my students who are working with me. So it's open for discussion. Any questions, you can ask this. This is my contact. Anyone interested to work with the center or want to do any work, you can contact us. Thank you all. Any questions?